Good morning, Waterfront. Good morning. Is this on? Hello, hello, it is on. Good morning and welcome to our service. Good morning as well if you're watching home online. It's a lovely day to be in church today. It's not raining, so that was a really good thing this morning, though it is bitter, isn't it? I hope as you arrived you got a notice sheet. Inside the notice sheet there's lots of important information. But most of you will have seen or heard already by now that our dear brother, Pastor Warren, has gone to be with his Lord and Saviour. And we as a church, we grieve a great loss. I only knew him for a few years, but it's true that he lived for Christ. And I'm excited for him now that he's died and is in the game. So we praise the Lord for that. Funeral details will come out in the coming days, I'm sure. There we go, we've got some lights as well. Okay then, also some other things to draw your attention to in the notice sheet. Sunday culture isn't in there, but Sunday culture, if you're a student or a young adult, Sunday culture will be back on next week. We'll have food and things after the service, so join us there. But my great excitement is the announcement for tonight is our first evening service. Yeah, some people are happy about it. Okay, some people are clapping about it. Appreciate that. Paul Ashman will be speaking at that first one. We'll have refreshments first, though, and then the service will begin. So come at 6 o'clock for refreshments first. How about we stand as a congregation? I'm going to pray for us, and then we're going to sing our first song. So let's stand together as I pray. Heavenly Father, we thank you that we as a church are your people. We thank you that we get to gather together and worship. We are thankful that where two or three are gathered, there you are also. And we're thankful that there are way more than two or three today. So we're thankful that we know your presence among us. Father, we thank you for your son, Jesus. We thank you for his life, for his death, for his resurrection, his ascension, and for how he sits interceding for us today. Lord, I pray you would hear our songs, you would hear our hearts worship, and you would be glorified by our gathering this morning. So be with us, we pray. We pray in Jesus' name. Amen.
We're going to start without some instruments today. Just our voices and our hearts worshiping God. Because he lives, I can face tomorrow.
Because he lives, I can face tomorrow. Because he
because he lives, God said.
take your seats. I'm going to ask Rachel to come and read a passage for us. But while she's coming, I'm going to tell you the passage so you can turn to it. So by the time she's here, you will have turned there. It's Romans chapter 5. Please turn in your Bibles if you have them. And if you don't, by the way, we do have Bibles in the church. So anyone that doesn't have one and would like one, you can always give us a wave and we can get one to you. So Romans chapter 5. We're there, okay.
Therefore, since we have been justified by faith, we have peace with God through our Lord Jesus Christ. Through him we have also obtained access by faith into this grace in which we stand, and we rejoice in the hope of the glory of God. Not only that, but we rejoice in our sufferings, knowing that suffering produces endurance, and endurance produces character, and character produces hope. And hope does not put us to shame, because God's love has been poured into our hearts through the Holy Spirit who has been given to us. But while we were still weak, at the right time, Christ died for the ungodly. For one will scarcely die for a righteous person, though perhaps for a good person one would dare even to die. But God shows his love for us in that while we were still sinners, Christ died for us. Since, therefore, we have now been justified by his blood, much more shall we be saved by him from the wrath of God. For if while we were enemies, we were reconciled to God through the death of his Son, much more, now that we are reconciled, shall we be saved by his life. More than that, we also rejoice in God through our Lord Jesus Christ, through whom we have now received reconciliation. Therefore, just as sin came into the world through one man, and death through sin, and so death spread to all men because all sinned, for sin indeed was in the world before the law was given, but sin is not counted where there is no law. Yet death reigned from Adam to Moses, even over those whose sinning was not like the transgression of Adam, who was a type of the one who was to come. But the free gift is not like the trespass. For if many died through one man's trespass, much more have the grace of God and the free gift by the grace of that one man, Jesus Christ, abounded for many. And the free gift is not like the result of that one man's sin. For the judgment following one trespass brought condemnation, but the free gift following many trespasses brought justification. For if because of one man's trespass, death reigned through that one man, much more will those who receive the abundance of grace and the free gift of righteousness reign in life through the one man, Jesus Christ. Therefore, as one trespass led to condemnation for all men, so one act of righteousness leads to justification and life for all men. For as by the one man's disobedience the many were made sinners, so by the one man's obedience the many will be made righteous. Now the law came in to increase the trespass, but where sin increased, grace abounded all the more, so that as sin reigned in death, grace also might reign through righteousness, leading to eternal life through Jesus Christ our Lord.
Thank you. Thanks, Gal. Just to also draw your attention to a notice in the sheet. This Wednesday is not the 10th of January. That has already happened. So Seniors Fellowship is on the 24th this week. I'm going to pray for us for our service. We've got some things to pray for specifically. Obviously, Pastor Warren's family and his wife and children, grandchildren. And also, Pastor Kerry is in hospital. He had a fall yesterday, I think it was. So he is in hospital. So I'm just going to pray for our service. Heavenly Father, we thank you that you are a good God. We thank you that you are a gracious God. We thank you that you are a merciful God. Father, we thank you that so many of us here can share testimony of your grace, your kindness, and your mercy and love toward us. Father, we are thankful for legendary saints who lead the way for us younger folk in the church. So, Father, we're so thankful for Warren's life. We're so thankful that he would have had such a great, good, and welcome to his faith, him being a faithful servant. Father, we're thankful for his ministries, for all of the things and the ways he's pointed so many of us to you. Lord, we also pray for his family, for Anne. Lord, we pray that you would be with her. We pray you would comfort her. We pray you would meet with her as she needs, basically, Lord. For the family as well, for his best friends, many in our congregation, Lord, we pray you would comfort those who are sad and grieving. And Father, would you remind us that for us who are believers, we don't grieve like the rest of the world, as if we don't have hope. We do have hope, and we know that he is safe, and that we'll be reunited with Pastor Warren when we meet the King as well. So Father, help us look forward to that day where we're with you. We pray for Pastor Kerry. Lord, we pray that you would heal him and restore whatever it is that has been broken by his fall. We pray, Lord, be with him, be with his wife, and be with the kids as well. Lord, be with our service. We pray we'd be with us as we gather around the table now. And would we remember? Would we remember the sacrifice of Calvary? We also pray, Lord, for the preaching of the word today. Would you be glorified? Would you be proclaimed? Would your name be made known through Arnie's preaching this morning? We love you, Lord. We're so thankful for you being among us and all you've done for us. So speak to us this morning, I pray. I pray in Jesus' name. Amen. Amen. Let's stand and sing "When Peace Like a River."
Or "When I Survey the Wondrous Cross."
Oh, when I survey the wondrous cross.
Love so amazing. Demands my life, my soul, my all. See from his hands, his head, his feet. Sorrow and love flow mingled down. And that's what we're celebrating this morning. That's what we're remembering this morning. The great sacrifice that Christ made on the cross for us. Can anyone explain it? No, not really. Because that, the fact that the loved one of heaven should come to earth, should breathe the air we breathe, should walk the paths we walk, and yet would go to the cross for us. And the Bible says that in this is love, not that we loved him, but that he loved us. So he didn't even do it because we asked him to. He did it because we needed him to do it. I can't explain that, not in words that make sense anyway. But the Apostle Paul, when he was reminding the church to come and remember this, says, "For I received from the Lord what I also delivered to you, that the Lord Jesus Christ, on the night he was betrayed, took bread. When he had given thanks, he broke it. This is my body, which is for you. This is the sacrifice. This is what I'm going to do for you," he's saying. "Do this in remembrance of me." In the same way, he also took the cup after supper. "This cup is the new covenant in my blood. Do this as often as you drink in remembrance of me. For as often as you eat this bread and drink this cup, you proclaim the Lord's death until he comes. Whoever therefore eats the bread or drinks the cup of the Lord in an unworthy manner will be guilty concerning the body and the blood of the Lord. Let a person examine himself then, and so eat of the bread and drink of the cup. For anyone who eats and drinks without discerning the body eats and drinks in judgment to themselves." So this is a reminder for Christians. So if you're a believer here this morning, this is to remind you. We're forgetful. Do you agree? We're forgetful? Yeah. We forget what we're supposed to remember. So this is for us to look back and remember what Christ did for us and to say we believe in Christ. We put our faith in you. If you're not a believer here this morning, it's better you let this pass and come and speak to us afterwards and we'll explain to you exactly what this is all about. But if the service could come forward, I'm going to pray and then we're going to eat and drink together. Heavenly Father, we can't truly comprehend what went on at Calvary. But Lord God, we come with thankful hearts to say thank you for doing it. Thank you for sending Jesus. Thank you that my sin is nailed to his cross and I bear it no more. Thank you that the tomb is empty, Lord God. Thank you that he rose triumphant over death and hell. And Lord God, that there is a new covenant, that whoever believes in him shall not perish, but shall have eternal life. As we eat and we drink, Lord God, help us to remember. Help us to comprehend a little deeper what Christ had to do at Calvary for us. Help us to re-give our lives. That song said it demands our souls, our lives, our all. Lord, help us to give our all to you for Jesus' sake. Amen. We're going to eat and drink together, so as soon as you've got them, if you could hold on to them, and we'll take them together. Thank you. Is there anybody who would like to partake but hasn't had? If you just raise your hand and one of the servers would come. Jesus said, "This is my body which is broken for you. Take and eat." In the same way, after supper, he took the drink. He said, "This is the new covenant, the new promise, the new agreement in my blood. Let's drink this together." Amen. James, as the servers are collecting up, will you lead us in worship? Thank you.
God has put it on my heart this morning just to read verse from Proverbs, or two verses from Proverbs. Proverbs 1:7, which says, "The fear of the Lord is the beginning of knowledge, but fools despise wisdom and instruction." Proverbs 9:10 says, "The fear of the Lord is the beginning of wisdom, and knowledge of the Holy One is understanding." Should we pray before we start singing our worship? Feel free to stand if you want, if you're able. Holy Spirit, we need you. We acknowledge you in our lives and the work that has been started through your power to embolden us and guide us, to gift us because of that resurrection power of Christ. Father God, we need a healthy fear of you in our lives, because as we've heard, it is the start of all knowledge and understanding. But we know that it is not just a head knowledge, academic words that we need to understand, but it is you, and a fear of you, the Holy One. And so we ask this morning that however that is expressed in our lives, however you want to deal with this in that way, that you would give us, Holy Spirit, a healthy fear of you to lead to all the other things in our life that you are blessing us with and that you want to bless us with. Holy Spirit, we invite you here this morning. May our worship be worship that is in the heart and the depth of our soul and not just words coming out of our mouths. And from our heads. May it not just be words that we are singing that somebody else has written at some other time when they've written a song, but let it be worship from our hearts. Holy Spirit, please help us to engage in your plans this morning, and we invite you to come and do your work with us. Amen.
It is well with my soul. It is well. It is well with my soul.
Sing, it's well.
It is well with my soul. It is well with So I'm lifting up my hands, I'm lifting up my voice, I'm lifting up your name, and in your grace I rest. For your love has come to me and set me free. Trusting in your word, I'm trusting in your cross, I'm trusting in your blood and all your faithfulness. For your power at work in me is changing me.
Let's sing again.
For I'm lifting up my hands, lifting up my voice, lifting up your name, and in your grace I rest. For your love
on that cross as Jesus died. The Indeed it is, our God. Let's take our seats. If you're a visitor with us this morning and this is your first time with us, you probably would have picked up by now that it's been a tough week for us as a church. We have lost one of the great pillars of the church and of our movement. And this morning, I don't do this normally when someone has passed away. I don't want to set a precedent, but I'm sure we all agree Warren Jones was unique. And so I want to pay tribute to him by way of my message this morning. We'll have his picture up again just to remind ourselves what a great man. What a great man of God. A giant of the faith has died. A servant of the Lord has entered his eternal rest. This morning I want to break from my study in Mark and pay tribute to Pastor Warren Jones, someone that the Apostolic Church had recognized as an apostle in the body of Christ, but he saw himself as a servant of Christ and of his church. And throughout his long service, he served with dignity, with humility, and with sincerity. And as I think of the ministry of Warren Jones, my mind goes back to the Old Testament and to the book of the prophet Jeremiah and to Jeremiah's call to ministry. Let me read them to you. They are verses 4 through to 10 of Jeremiah chapter 1. And this is what is recorded. The word of the Lord came to me saying, before I formed you in the womb, I knew you. Before you were born, I set you apart. I appointed you as a prophet to the nations. Alas, sovereign Lord, I said, I do not know how to speak. I'm too young. But the Lord said to me, do not say I am too young. You must go to everyone I send you to and say whatever I command you. Do not be afraid of them, for I am with you and will rescue you, declares the Lord. Then the Lord reached out his hand and touched my mouth and said to me, I have put my words in your mouth. See, today I appoint you over nations and kingdoms to uproot and tear down, to destroy and overthrow, to build and to plant. From this passage this morning, let me highlight three things about the call of Jeremiah that could also be said of Warren Jones. First, like Jeremiah, Warren Jones was a man appointed by God. Look at verse 5. Before I formed you in the womb, I knew you. Before you were born, I set you apart. I appointed you as a prophet to the nations. Without any fear of contradiction this morning, I can say that Warren Jones was a man appointed by God in the councils of eternity. Warren would be the first to admit that he wasn't perfect. Like Jeremiah of old, and every single one of us here this morning, he had his flaws and failures. Nevertheless, he was God's appointed man because he was a man after God's own heart. As a young teenager, he surrendered his life to the will of God. Warren could say with a great missionary, Spencer Walton, Thy will, O Lord, nothing more, nothing less, nothing else. I remember him telling me that as a teenager, he responded to an altar call at the then International Convention of the Apostolic Church, which was held in the village of Penygros, and an altar call was given for those who wanted to surrender their lives, not in salvation, but surrender their lives to the will and service of God. And he responded. And the will of God was paramount in his life. He wanted to be obedient to the will of God, whatever God asked of him and wherever God would send him. God saw his heart, and he became a man appointed by God. And the challenge for you and for me this morning, as we consider the life and legacy of this man, where is the will of God as far as your Christian life is in question? Is the will of God paramount? Or is it something we are prepared to yield to if it slots into our agenda? Is coming to church on a Sunday the sum total of our Christian lives? But are we willing to surrender our lives completely to God's will and serve him in whatever capacity he may ask us to? Are we willing to make personal sacrifices in order to submit to God's will? You see, Warren, along with his wife Anne, made huge personal sacrifices in order to be in the will of God, and they never regretted it. He sacrificed the comforts of home and went as a missionary to Brazil. He was offered pastorates of large churches with other denominations, but he sacrificed the prestige of pastoring big congregations because he believed the will of God for him was to serve in this small denomination known as the Apostolic Church. Prior to being called to full-time Christian ministry, Warren worked in education. And we all know his ability in communication and his leadership skills. And we know for a fact he could have risen to the top of his profession and be earning a big salary. But he sacrificed gold for the will of God. I know of men who have given up good salaries to become church pastors and then find that they cannot live comfortably on a pastor's salary, and they've given it up and gone back to secular employment in order to earn the big bucks. But not Warren Jones. The will of God was paramount to him. And the challenge to us all this morning, how committed are we to the will of God? Jeremiah was a man appointed by God, and he fulfilled the will of God by obeying the word of God and went wherever God led him. And yes, Warren Jones was a man appointed by God, and the will of God was paramount in his life, and he too obeyed God's will, no matter what the cost. And thank God, in retirement, the will of God was for him to retire in Swansea and make this church his home. and we have been so blessed and enriched by his ministry. The second thing, like Jeremiah, Warren Jones was a man with a message from God. Look at verse 9. Then the Lord reached out his hand and touched my mouth and said, I have put my words in your mouth. You see, Jeremiah was not someone who prophesied his own thoughts. He was not someone with an agenda. He was not a prophet looking for a name and therefore prophesying what the people wanted to hear. He came with a message from the throne room of heaven. And again, I can say without any fear of contradiction, every time I heard Warren preach, he conveyed something of God. In his preaching, he never promoted himself, his agenda, or his ideas. He never entered the pulpit without having been in the study, immersing himself in the Word of God. His heart, in all his preaching, was to proclaim the unsearchable riches of Christ. He wasn't into sound bites. He wasn't into gimmicks. He was never on an ego trip, and he never bragged about his own achievements. Warren was committed to the Word of God and bringing that Word alive to you and to me. Warren was committed to the Word of God in two ways. First, he proclaimed the gospel of grace because he believed it to be the power of God unto salvation. His greatest desire was to see souls saved. Time and time again, he used to tell me, Arnallt, what we need is to see souls saved. As far as Warren was concerned, no other religion, philosophy, ideology gives a person what the gospel offers. Yes, there are some good ideas and positive stuff about living within the teachings of other faiths, and he didn't deny that. Yes, there are some great philosophical ideas out there. Yes, people have come up with some fantastic ideas on how to better ourselves, the world, and the future. However, there is nothing in the whole universe that can offer you and me what the gospel of Jesus Christ can offer. The gospel that Warren preached offered sinful man reconciliation with the Holy God. The gospel that Warren preached offered sinful man peace with the Holy God. The gospel that Warren preached offered sinful man a loving relationship with the Holy God. This is what, you see, the gospel does. This is what the gospel has done for me. This God of heaven burns in his holy splendor. And how can I stand this morning when I look and think of the light of God's holiness? I'm doomed. But the gospel offers me hope. It was T. Pinney in his hymn who thought when he began to think about the searchlight of God's holiness, he said, oh, how shall I, whose native sphere is dark, whose mind is dim, how shall I, he says, before the ineffable appear and on my naked spirit bear the uncreated beam. When the beam of God's holiness is upon me, I'm doomed, I'm lost, I've had it. But Pinney saw that ray of light that came from Calvary, and Warren Jones saw that ray of light, and he gladly proclaimed it. And so Pinney says, there is a way, you see, for man to rise to that sublime abode, an offering and a sacrifice. A Holy Spirit energizes an advocate with God. Hallelujah this morning. Thank God for the gospel. The gospel that Warren preached offers full pardon and cleansing to me from all my sin. The gospel that Warren preached releases me and frees me from sin's bondage. The gospel that he preached set me totally free from past failures and gives me a fresh start and a new life. This was the message that Warren Jones received from God. And without fear, he was faithful to this message. And the second thing about the word, the preaching of Warren Jones, he proclaimed the fundamental doctrines of the Christian faith because he believed that they had power to edify believers and thus enabling them to live a Jesus lifestyle in a corrupt world. Those of you who spent some time with Warren and knew that he had a grasp of theology that was second to none. One of his greatest concerns was that Western Christendom was watering down the orthodox evangelical theological stance. I can hear Warren say with Jude of old and challenging us all this morning, contend for the faith that was once and for all delivered to the saints. Yes, Warren was a man with a message from God. He was undoubtedly one of the greatest preachers I have ever heard. He was indeed a prince of preachers. And let me let you into a secret. When he retired to Swansea and started attending this church, it took me about 6 months before I could relax to preach, because it was like preaching before the great Dr. Martin Lloyd-Jones when you had Warren in your congregation. And then finally, like Jeremiah, Warren Jones was a man who had experienced the touch of God. Look at verse 9. Then the Lord reached out his hand and touched my mouth. Warren Jones was a preacher who knew the touch of God. He was a man full of the Holy Spirit and fire. While every sermon he preached was anchored and submerged in Scripture, yet he was aware that unless the message was touched by the Holy Spirit, he was only giving a talk and sharing information. And Warren was not into talks. He was a preacher. And the anointing of the Holy Spirit must be the preacher's greatest need. His earnest desire and deepest longing was for God to breathe on his preaching. He lived for preaching. That was his big thing. And he used to tell me, Arnallt, I want to die preaching. And thank God, God was gracious. And even up to the last few months, he was able to stand here and preach. And I was talking to his son, Ian, and when he was slipping in and out of consciousness, all of a sudden, he sat up. And for 20 minutes, his hands out, and he preached to them, and then finished. Wonderful how God, and then they heard his his last sermon. And in his confusion, because he was confused, with the medication and stuff towards the end, yet his preaching was clear. It's amazing. It's absolutely amazing. And you don't need to tell me this morning that he was a preacher with a touch of God. Every time Warren stood behind this lectern, you had a sense of God. And this is challenging this morning to us all as preachers, and there are many preachers in this congregation this morning. It's a challenge to us. Because you see, the best prepared sermon and the most theologically sound sermon is lifeless unless it has the breath of the Holy Spirit. And Warren could say with Paul in 1 Thessalonians 1 and 5, our gospel came to you not simply with words, but also with power and in the Holy Spirit and with deep conviction. Because preaching is a part of God's economy, it's vitally important for those who deliver its message allow themselves to be used of God's Holy Spirit to speak to men. You see, a preacher may be blessed with intellect, and this is of tremendous advantage to him in preparation, and Warren was a man of great intellect. A preacher may be blessed with the understanding of the laws of homiletics, and this can be of great benefit to him in setting out his sermon in a way that people could grasp and remember the message. A preacher can be blessed with a wonderful gift of oratory that enables him to deliver his message with moving compassion and conviction. Advantageous as all these are, yet they mean nothing in real terms without the anointing of the Holy Spirit. You see, Dr. Jim McConnell said this of leaders, and it's equally true of preachers. He said, what is a leader without the anointing? He's only a glorified supervisor. And listen, a preacher without the anointing is only giving a speech. And that's the bottom line. We're only giving a speech unless we have something of the Holy Spirit. And I believe with all my heart that the Holy Spirit speaks through preaching today. And let me tell you, Warren Jones was proof of this. The Holy Spirit, who spoke through Peter's preaching on the day of Pentecost, spoke through Warren's preaching, and he still speaks today. Those who occupy the pulpit here at Waterfront, let me tell you, and I'm preaching to myself as much as any other preacher who will stand here, our greatest need, my greatest need in preaching is the presence of God, the Holy Ghost. The great Dr. Martin Lloyd-Jones asked and answered his own question about preaching when he said this: what is the chief end of preaching? And he goes on to say, I like to think it's this. It is to give men and women a sense of God and his presence. That is the end goal, really, of all preaching. Not to show off our intellect, not to give wonderful sound bites, but to give our congregation the sense of God. And Lloyd-Jones used to say that he could forgive almost anything in a preacher, providing he gave him the sense of And friends, Warren did this successfully. Warren knew that as a preacher, he hadn't been called to deliver talks, speeches, addresses, or discourses. He had been called to preach Jesus. Jesus was everything. How many times did you hear him stand here and say that he loved Jesus and proclaim Jesus? And he preached Jesus from the book. And he did so in the power of the Holy Spirit. And this he did with excellence. And this morning, we salute the memory of a man who lived for God and for the will of God and to proclaim the word of God. And may God raise up young men to do the same. And I can't finish really without throwing out a challenge to young men in this service. Warren's heart was for young people. He prayed in the prayer meeting and he made a declaration of faith that God would bring 50 young people. Remember that night in here? Now, we know if God was to answer that prayer, things would change here. And let's be honest, we don't like change. But God heard his prayer. And here we are this morning. But young people, he would have me tell you this morning, surrender your lives. Don't come to church and just fool around. Surrender your lives wholeheartedly to the will of God. Whatever he asks, wherever he sends you, be willing, be obedient to say, yes, Lord, here am I, send me. And young men, because he had a passion for young men preaching the word of God. Give yourselves. Don't wait to see some bright light from heaven with the words on it you are to preach. Give yourself to the word of God. And when God gives you a word, share it with the world. Let's pray. Father, we thank you this morning that most of us, if not all of us, have had the privilege of sitting under the ministry of this great man of God. And while he has been promoted to his eternal reward, we thank you that as men leave, you prepare others. Your work still goes on. And I just pray that there will be men and women, young people in this place this morning who will be prepared to say, I surrender all to thee, my blessed Savior. I surrender all. And I would just ask, Father, that you would respond this morning in grace to Warren's prayer, that in this place this morning, the seed of many a preacher will be sown. For Jesus' sake, amen.
Thank you, Pastor Arnie. We're going to stand and sing our final hymn, but before we do, that's it, team, come on forward. Thank you for singing for us this morning as well. Let me remind you, our evening service this evening at 6 o'clock for refreshment, 6:30 the service begins, and the collection basket is going to go around as we stand and sing now. And as we're not ready, let's fill some more time. Let's stand, shall we?
Church, let's pray. Father God, I thank you for your unquestionable presence amongst us here this morning. I thank you, Father God, that we've been able to pay tribute to an amazing servant, to a giant of the faith. But Father, whilst we mourn and in part we grieve, Father, we also rejoice. Twofold, Father, he is now with you. And we thank you that that is the eternal hope, the everlasting arms, the truth that is ours for those who believe you, for those who call you Lord and Savior. There's no disjoint, Father God, in what your word says to what happens, to what you've done, to what you're doing, to what you will do. And to that end, we thank you for the legacy of Warren Jones. Father, we thank you for the pages unyet written. And I thank you for the men and women who are going to be taking up the pens to write those pages. And I pray that in this place, Father God, we will see bold souls willing to stand up, to proclaim, declare the faith, stand true in your word. And Father, to be ministers of your grace. Would you make it so? In Jesus' good name and for your glory. Amen. Good morning. God bless you.